Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to join my colleagues in expressing their support for the motion which is before this House. The member from Castries East explained that this was a motion which started from the time of the leadership of the member for Beaufort South. It is a continuation of a benefit offered by the government for families that have relatives overseas who are able to send them barrels. And it even extended to persons in the middle class who go overseas to shop and to send their goods and other commodities to St. Lucia. And I want to express my support because I know many of my constituents are looking forward to this time of the year when they can benefit from the barrels concessions. Mr. Speaker, the member for Miku South, in responding to the member of Castries East, sought to expand his presentation beyond the subject matter of the motion, and he justified it on the basis that the member from Castries East had dealt with a number of issues. But, Mr. Speaker, I too would like to take the latitude and respond to some of the issues that were raised. The member from Miku South says that this should be extended to June. He claims he's a champion of the poor, he's speaking on behalf of the poor, and that things are hard in this country. Mr. Speaker, every single one of us will agree that things are hard. We know it is hard. It is hard globally, Mr. Speaker. Globally. There is a crisis facing the world economy. Rising inflation. Countries are struggling to bring it under control. And of course, as an open economy, we import inflation. He himself used the term imported inflation. So we all know it is hard. It is because it is so hard that this government has gone out of its way to give so much support to the poor people of this country, Mr. Speaker, including the distribution of food vouchers to many of our needy constituents. So we know it is hard, Mr. Speaker. This member, and you would recall, never during the COVID period extended this to June. Never did. During COVID, when things were so difficult in this country, things were so hard globally, he never, as a champion of the poor, extended it to June. Do you know what they did, Mr. Speaker? They expanded the concessions under the barrels. It's only this government that brought it back to what it was. I don't know how many members remember that in here. It was expanded to include lights, personal gifts of parliamentarians, and a set of other items that they could have brought in duty-free. We stood up in this House as members of the opposition and we decried it. We said that was not the rationale for this benefit provided to poor people in this country. That's what they did. The same person who's standing up here saying he's a champion of the poor and this should be extended to June, never extended it to June when it was most needed. And in fact, what he did was to expand the benefits so they could benefit more from it. When we came into government in July 2021, we amended it and brought it back in line with what it was intended to be. Mr. Speaker, but he professes to be a champion of the poor. Now, Mr. Speaker, in a later debate this afternoon under the Investment Amendment Act, I will deal with the GPH issue. I'll take my time and go through the GPH issue because the member is notorious for his untruths, Mr. Speaker. He's notorious for it, Mr. Speaker. The member is standing up in this House and saying, you sold the port. Why did you, how did we sell the port? Well, if you give a concession to somebody for 30 years or 40 years and they're collecting the revenue, then you have sold it. Now, does that make sense? Is that what sale is? But he's all over saying that we've sold the port. But I'll come back to GPH just after, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to give a couple of other issues, Mr. Speaker. He says that SLASPA has been bankrupted by this agreement. Again, Mr. Speaker, I will respond to you this afternoon. I will explain to you what percentage of SLASPA revenue is from cruise tax, what percentage is from seaport operations, and I'll explain it, Mr. Speaker. And I hope he's there. He wouldn't be there. I hope he's there this afternoon. If I know you will not be there, I'll deal with it now, or you'll be right there. But let's deal with an issue, Mr. Speaker, that he brought up, a ticklish one, about the leader must be a St. Lucian. And he called on the member from Castries East to sanction the member from Castries Central because he said they should have a referendum on how we plan to change the law so that the leader of the country must be born in St. Lucia. So, Mr. Speaker, what is wrong with the people in St. Lucia having a debate as to whether their leader must be born in their country? But what is wrong with this? In the U.S., for you to be president, you must be born in the U.S. Each one of us have our own views as to whether the head of government and head of state should be born in St. Lucia. We all have our views.
Member for Castries South. Yes, member for Miku South.
Yeah, Ms. Speaker, the member is misleading the House. I never said that the member should, of Castries Central be sanctioned for his comments about the citizenship. I said he should be sanctioned for being on his show and saying that he was receiving information from police officers on citizens of this country. And I was only bringing up the reference of the point that the member from Castries Central made about citizenship, because the Prime Minister says he doesn't know where that came from. It came from his own colleague. I just want a point of clarification. I have no issues with any debate to take place in this country. And in fact, I think it's so important. I think we should have a referendum on it.
Thank you, Member for Miku South, but please don't stand on a point of order and end on a point of clarification. The two are entirely different. Member for Castries South.
So, Mr. Speaker, I think it's a debate we should have in this country.
Yes.
We should have it. We should have it. We don't necessarily need to have a referendum. I don't know, the constitutional lawyers will decide whether you have to have referendum or not. I don't know. There are certain things in the Constitution that requires referendum, and there are those that do not require referendum. But, Mr. Speaker, because if you said you were born in Martinique because there were complications with your birth, and if you then said you became a citizen of the United States, and are you still a citizen of the United States? I don't know. Or whether you gave it up or whatnot, and that you are a product of Canada, and you were a citizen of Canada, and you are a citizen of Ireland, it gets complicated. So, Mr. Speaker. I didn't say you. I said, I don't know if you said you, I don't know if you are this or you are that or that. But let's move on. Let's move on. But let's have the debate. And I wish we would have the debate on whether the leader and the leader of government and state should be St. Lucian. I think we should have the broader constitutional debates in this country as to how we structure our government, Mr. Speaker. And I know that there is an effort being made for us to complete that process that was started by the member from Beaufort South. But the member said what he really spoke about was that the member from Castries Central said that he was getting information from the police about private citizens. And that's not true, Mr. Speaker. The member did not say that. The members, from my recollection, the member was referring to his times when he was a lawyer. And he said that he had gone to the police station and he had gotten information, blah, blah, blah. But Mr. Speaker, this member has no shame. No shame. You want to speak about persons getting information from the police, politicians. This member, the member of the Minister for National Security in his government, announced publicly that he, as the Minister of National Security, would have weekly meetings with the DPP and the AG at the time so they can coordinate their actions. Think about that. That is dangerous. The Minister of National Security, the DPP, and the AG are meeting weekly to coordinate their actions. Isn't there a separation that's supposed to take place? He said so. But let me tell you more about that member from Miku South that speaks about information from the police. Mr. Speaker, everybody knows my history, my short experience so far in this political arena. The member has come after me full blast. He tried everything, Mr. Speaker, and I survived it, and I will continue to survive it, Mr. Speaker. And one day, in our private moments, I'll tell you my secret, Mr. Speaker. Do you know what happened? He set up a special investigative unit to investigate me. Yeah. They went to the United Kingdom, Mr. Speaker. On their second visit, COVID struck and the UK shut down, and they were trapped, they were locked up in a hotel in the UK. I don't want to call their names. They went all over the UK. They asked the Scotland Yard to investigate me. I have the emails that were sent, Mr. Speaker. Emails that were sent asking people information about me in the UK. He did it. It gets worse, Mr. Speaker. The second in command in the High Commission came back to St. Lucia, and the investigative unit asked to interview him. And do you know where they asked him to come for the interview? At the residence of the Prime Minister.
Wow.
I am saying it in this house, and I will say it in public. I've said it in public before. The unit asked him to come to the residence of the Prime Minister for an interview. And his lawyer told him under no circumstances that would happen. He could not believe that. Could not believe that. He, the member from Miku South, and he wants to chastise a member who said, who is a lawyer, who went to the police to get information on a client. It gets worse. This member from Miku South would write to the United States government to ask them to get into my Gmail account and provide them with all my Gmail emails, all of them, so he can read my Gmail messages to see what I've been doing. He, the member from Miku South, Mr. Speaker. No, you're saying we say that. Okay, Mr. Speaker, this member from Miku South, this talks about politicians getting information from the police.
Yeah.
Send police to my house to search my house, Mr. Speaker. Yes. And you stood up in your little balcony watching, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this member.
Mr. Speaker,
Mr. Speaker.
The member is making
member for
the member is misleading the House. There's no way a
Prime Minister can continue,
give any order for any of those things. I challenge him to provide any evidence that a Prime Minister would have sat there and given any order for a person's house to be searched. There's a process that has to go through, and it's not within the purview of a Prime Minister to do that. So I would like him to withdraw that statement, Mr. Speaker, because it's categorically false, and it gives the wrong impression of what transpired.
Mr. Speaker, I start off by saying to you that the Minister of National Security, the DPP and the AG, the Minister of National Security said, his name is Mr. Francis, maybe you might know him, Mr. Speaker, that he and the DPP and the AG, sat together and coordinated their actions. He said so in public. In public. A very famous Mr. Francis. Mr. Speaker, very famous one. But Mr. Speaker,
member, he has asked that you withdraw the statement about the Prime Minister gave the instructions.
Withdraw the statement that the Prime Minister gave the instructions.
I gave the instructions to search your home. How can I give instructions to search?
Mr. Speaker, I can go even further. Mr. Chico, who was a former controller of customs, Mr. Speaker, wrote a report saying that the Prime Minister, this member from Miku South, directed him to go after Ernest Sille. That was in a report prepared, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, can I proceed? Honorable member from Miku South, I have said to you, Mr. Speaker, member from Miku South, I have learned in life that you don't harbor hate. You don't destroy who you are as a person for have hatred or disdain, dislike for people. You fight your battles and you move on. So, but I've just started, Honorable Member. Honorable Member, I have just started. You have a torturous future ahead of you. Mr. Speaker, let me go on. So, Mr. Speaker, we have a long day here. I'll be coming back again. The member from Miku South speaks about the patrimony of St. Lucia being sold. because of the lease arrangement with GPH. Can you imagine that? The member from Miku South.
Yes.
He had so much disdain for St. Lucia.
Yeah.
He stood up in a global forum and dismissed the value of our country and our people, and said all this talk about patrimony and preserving is nonsense. Your patrimony is measured by your credit rating. And other prime ministers had looked at him shocked. In fact, one described him thereafter as a not too smart prime minister. You as a prime minister of St. Lucia stood up in a global forum, and rather than protect the heritage and the patrimony of your country, you dissed St. Lucia. Said it was nonsense those people in St. Lucia were talking about preserving, and that your patrimony is measured by your credit rating. And you want to come here today. You want to come here today and to say that you, Mr. Speaker, care about St. Lucia and that we are selling the patrimony of St. Lucia. But we'll come again to this, Mr. Speaker. A final comment, Mr. Speaker, because I know the member from Castries just want to tie up this debate. Tourism arrivals. Mr. Speaker, you know, I'll tell you something else, Mr. Speaker. I have had some wonderful teachers in my life, academic-wise, professional, and even political, Mr. Speaker. And you learn sometimes, Mr. Speaker, to stay focused on what's important and don't let the noise distract you. This is a member who was Minister of Tourism, got $50 million a year to promote tourism. The member from Castries North was his prime minister, gave him $50
million.
He promised him 7 hotels. And a lot of things, Mr. Speaker. What he was most noted for? What he was most noted for was a monthly telephone bill of about $60,000, and his travels and the hotel expenses. That's what he was most noted for, Mr. Speaker. Nothing distinguishable about him during his time as Minister of Tourism. And he's supposed to be a tourism guru. He came back as Prime Minister.
He lost one investment, $20 million.
Well, we don't even talk about that. I'll leave that this afternoon. He came back as Prime Minister. Came back as Prime Minister and has nothing to show in his 5 years as Prime Minister of Tourism. Not one hotel was built in St. Lucia during his time as Minister of Tourism or as Prime Minister.
On the point of order.
Before Miku South.
I've heard the member from, Mr. Speaker, on the point of order, members just misleading the House again. I've heard the member several times, and you know what, I've chosen not to say it, where he says that not one hotel was built during my tenure. That's not true.
Which one?
No. The new high-end hotel there. The 40 rooms. Okay. Yes.
Which one?
In Coconut Bay.
Where?
The second hotel that they have there. You don't know that? A brand new hotel. Okay? 40 rooms.
14 rooms?
40 rooms. Okay? The Cabot was taking place. Okay? The Marriott Courtyard that's broken ground. Who did it? You did it.
Did you do it?
Did you do it? Yes, I did.
Okay,
where's the one who is already being built? It's on the fifth floor. Huh?
No, I didn't ask.
So the member continues to say it, Mr. Speaker, that no new rooms were built. That's a categorical lie.
You know, Mr. Speaker, can I continue, please? You know, the member is so delusional. The developer who's building the hotel at Marriott was brought to St. Lucia under Dr. Kenny Anthony's administration. They came, they wanted to build a number of hotels in St. Lucia. A number of hotels. They came to build a number of hotels. I can tell you that, Mr. Speaker, because I was involved in the discussions. The first hotel they thought of starting was Shabusha in Srozelle, and they were going to look for other properties to build a number of other hotels in St. Lucia. Of course, they're building the second hotel now at Point Seraphim, and they will start a third next year in St. Lucia. They came under Dr. Anthony's watch. Mr. Speaker, so the same group that came, they started this one, They decided for, because there were issues with Shabusha, environmental issues, a set of issues. So they decided that was getting too difficult for them. They started a second one, and they will start a third next year because they came from the start to build a number of hotels in St. Lucia. They were diversifying from construction into hospitality. There's nothing new. The only thing that was brought into St. Lucia under the last government was Ojo Labs. And we all know the arrangement that was put in place for them. So anyway, let I don't even want to remind you of the origin. Anyway, but let me go on. So he's speaking about tourism arrivals. And Mr. Speaker, I know that every day they are longing to hear bad news about tourism. They want bad news about tourism. The truth is, Mr. Speaker, and I will present it at the appropriate time, tourism arrivals for this year will increase over last year. We had a difficult summer, like almost all other countries in the Caribbean. I can give you the data, Mr. Speaker. This afternoon, okay, he says nobody else had a difficult summer. This afternoon, I'll make a document of the House, the arrivals for all the other countries to show you how bad the others did. Because the summer was tight, there was no equipment, and the number of seats declined, Mr. Speaker. Now, all of what's happening, Mr. Speaker, I am no guru in tourism. I never worked in the hospitality sector. I'm no guru. I have some good teachers. I have some good colleagues in cabinet who share advice and opinions with me. And I learned well, Mr. Speaker. And I try to be a fast learner. We make mistakes, but we try to correct them as quickly as possible so we can move on in the business of the government. We do not start off by saying, I'm going to run this country as a business. I'm a CEO, Prime Minister. That's how they started off. They were not going to run this country for the people and putting the people first. He was going to be a CEO, Prime Minister, and he's going to run this as a business. And his first act was to say to St. Lucians, y'all cannot prepare a proper budget. So I'm going to bring in Ernst & Young and pay them $6 million to prepare a proper budget. The CEO, Prime Minister. 5 years later, where is the CEO, Prime Minister? Where is the CEO, Prime Minister? So, Mr. Speaker, he said Pinocchio like I lied. You know, seriously. Seriously. But, Mr. Speaker, Mr. Speaker, you know, can you imagine someone says he knows nothing about a levy to be introduced, and you produce the clipping for him, standing here in the teleprompters, saying they established a committee to invest, to prepare to introduce it, blah, 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 versus he's saying he knows nothing about that, he never heard about the levy, and he says that's fake. Well, I don't know. But Mr. Speaker, let me end by expressing my support for this. I don't know if you recall, Mr. Speaker, the last time the members came to this house, you don't know what they did with this resolution? They had ordered all the items, all. And they came to the house about 3 weeks before Christmas, remember that? In early December to pass the resolution, not telling us that. And they backdated it from September, because all their stuff had already been imported and was in St. Lucia. And they came here in December and said parliamentarians can order things for Christmas. That's what they did. That's what they did the last time he had a chance to pass this motion. Very deceitful. So, Mr. Speaker, I express my support for this motion, and I look forward to we contributing as much as we can over the Christmas to bring some cheer and goodwill and to make it a little easier for our constituents. Thank you very much.